we start with New York, since we're welcoming Massimo in New York with an homage to New York. I remember you have a dish that sort of has a Manhattan skyline, and you lived in New York, and many things about the city inspired you. Wiley is a completely a New York chef, whatever that means, you know, and he kind of reinterpreted New York cuisine. What was it like for you to be in New York, and what do you still retain from it, and tell us about the skyline?
Thank you to be here, thanks. And New York, it was a very strange period. I was very, I was running a restaurant, a little trattoria outside of Modena. It was 1991, 92. And I had a club, very successful. And, you know, I was fooling around. And I said to my girlfriend, why don't we start again and leave everything and go to New York? And this was around November. I left everything.
What year was it?
1993.
Oh, 93, wow.
And then I left for New York. I was living kind of near, just like that, I was thinking about. Then I was walking one day, it was 7 on April, 1993, down in Seoul, on Grand Street, and I saw this label of an Italian coffee, and I said, oh, finally a great espresso. I'm gonna walk in. It was before Starbucks, because I don't know if you know that espresso is been created in Italy, not from Starbucks. Yeah, but you know, I said, I'm going here and have an espresso, but it took 20 minutes to have an espresso. So I said, maybe I think they have some problems, you know, because at the bar. So I just said, okay, why? I'm not doing anything. I have time. I left my number to this place. That was a beautiful place. You know, I didn't even start. I didn't even walk in, and I saw the answer machine in my apartment, and the answer machine like ding 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 ding. So I touched the button, and Ray Costantini, this hairdresser, very famous in the 60s and 70s, from Calabria, decided to open this restaurant, and he said, if you can come tomorrow, it would be great. So I went down there the day after, and I start. Actually, the same day, 7 of April, my future wife, Lara, she was acting at at the theater, the Worcester Theater, close to there, to Worcester, to Grand. She applied for a job at Caffè di Nonna the same day. And she went back in the apartment at Avenue A, where she was living, and she found the same message. You can come tomorrow, shift 2 to closing time. And we both start the 8th of April 1993 at Caffè di Nonna.
Wow.
That's the story.
Bravo, Caffè di Nonna.
Bravo, Caffè di Nonna. Okay, so this is my first approach with New York. And the thing that Anya was mentioning is bollito not boil, right? Bollito not boil is the way we approach to the food. What are we doing? We ask ourselves question that can be abstract, real, you know, as an architect, as a poet, you know, how can I compress words in few words, these elements, or how can I sign the landscape with a beautiful building that is matching perfect? How can I be ethic or evolve the boiling meat, bollito misto, that is so traditional in Italy? Because one day I walk into the kitchen and I saw these incredible pieces of meat on a counter. And I said, why do I have to boil this meat? because 1,000 of years of history told me that. But I'm not boiling the meat, and I'm a contemporary chef. And this meat is amazing. And these farmers, they're raising these animals over 2,000 meters with Fassona on the Alps, eating in open sky with incredible, you know, things. And if I boil the meat, I'm losing everything. Vitamin, protein, organoleptic parts. So I call immediately the professor of the university, Massimo Montanari, and I ask him why do I have to boil the meat? Why the bollito misto? How? So he told me all the story, like in 12th, 13th century, you know, the approach of the family that they were boiling the meat instead of grilling because like that they get broth and meat together. And so I said, Massimo, did it make sense this? He said, it absolutely makes sense. So we start. We start this, and we start trying to cook the meat in a different way. So we were using sous vide and low temperature to preserve everything. And 1 month, 2 months, 3 months, and we arrive at the point in which all these different parts of the meat was just perfectly cooked. And using that technique, I didn't lose the poetry of the 1,000 years of history.
And where did the Manhattan skyline came in?
I was playing with my Charlie, my son, at that time, at the park just 61st Street. You know, the park just outside, after 57, and I was playing there. I was lying on the grass, and I saw the skyline of Manhattan. I thought, so that's perfect. It's ironic, you know. I'm serving bollito misto with the shape of a skyline. American hates boiled meat, so I'm serving that, and it's like I'm creating all these pieces of meat. I gave the shape of all the buildings. And I create a bollito misto with the skyline of Manhattan, with all this salsa verde that was like the trees, and all this peperonata in line as it was like the people that were playing in the field. That was bollito misto.
And Wally, I mean, you had so many of your dishes were an homage to, you know, different parts of New York cuisine, you know, the Chinese, the deli sandwich. You know, how did New York inspire you?
Well, I mean, I think that that's a lot of what we draw on at the restaurant. We draw on memories. We draw on our geography a lot. We draw on iconic dishes. You know, the dish that was on the menu the longest at WD50 was a very simple thing. It was corn duck, and it was just an homage to Katz's, our proximity to Katz's delicatessen. It's corn duck instead of corned beef. It's on a piece of rye bread that we take bread, and something we still do to this day, we take pieces of bread, and instead of slicing them very thinly, like we were taught to do by previous chefs, we take the bread and we put it through a pasta machine. And we take a thick piece of bread and we just keep putting it through the pasta machine and putting it through the pasta machine over and over and over again. And the bread gets compressed, and then we dry it, and it changes the texture. It's not the same thing as a thin slice of bread. It's actually a very dense piece of bread. That's very thin. And in that case, we're just borrowing different elements from the classic Katz's sandwich to make a dish to honor that, our proximity, and the fact that I used to go there as a kid and have a corned beef sandwich and a celery soda. And so we tried originally when we opened up to actually make our own celery soda, but we never got something we're happy with. So instead, we just put a bunch of celery on top of the sandwich. And we often use those ideas, those inspirations. I mean, I think in terms of how we put food on the plate too, in terms of the shapes that our food takes, New York is very angular, and a lot of our food is very angular. We use the geometry, the geography of New York City to inspire us a lot.
But here's the deal, and I was talking to Massimo about it before, you know, this sort of deconstructive approach that reaches deep into, you know, memoria gustativa, the taste memory, and then kind of, you know, rearranges the elements so it comes fresh again in the mouth. And we were talking to Massimo, for instance, it was easy for the Scandinavians to reinvent, you know, this whole, to invent the whole new Nordic cuisine, because the actual, you know, the actual cuisine was Protestant and not that interesting, and Scandinavians, you know, kind of turned their back on it, on traditional cuisine. You come from two very different situations. You come from a place, a region, and a country that is so tradition-bound that if you put an extra clove of garlic in something, you know, they would call it carabinieri. And you come from a place...
It is true.
It is true. You come from a place where it's the cuisine is actually very hard to define because it's so heterogeneous. What is New York cuisine? So what was it like for you to become this iconoclast in this, you know, incredibly traditional place?
But for me, what has changed is that 10 years ago, they want to burn me in the main piazza as a witch. and now they call me maestro. So maestro, I say, maestro is Pavarotti, guys. I'm not maestro. And that's the point, because we, as this book, Never Trust a Skinny Italian Chef, is just a way to express the irony, and with that we don't have to take us so much so seriously. You know, we are cooks, and we have to be with the feet on the ground, and we just need to think and keep doing our job, but with two steps back and see everything very clear. You know, it's different. You know, the only thing that is changed for real is the people. When I talk now, they are listening. You know, they are listening what I have to say. Once they were saying yes, and then they say, refer to Bollito Misto, no? I remember the article after I presented a fantastic dish that is gonna change the perception of the old traditional cuisine, and then it was finished. But do you wanna lose the emotion of choose your piece with the big tray, with this beautiful meat and the smoke in the room? So it was killing me in that moment. With that article, with that finish, it just said, fuck you, you know, and your bolito not boil. And now the University of Parma is teaching bolito not boil at university. So that's the perception.
Well, that's the thing about being a trailblazer. I mean, you both chose a difficult route. You could have been making spaghetti al pomodoro or whatever. You could have been serving, after the success of 71 Clinton, you could have been serving, you know, lovely salads and, you know, a burger or two. You both chose to go against the grain. It's food that is requires, you know, a lot of cognitive engagement from the diner. It's not something you just like, da, da, da. It's food that gets, you know, bashed by critics. Wally, what was the most challenging moment for you in your career? Were there moments when you said, why am I doing this? I could be just making lovely salads. What's in it for me? Like,
I don't think I could ever make a lovely salad, to be honest.
Well, you did. You made, like, in your original restaurant, you made this very sort of lovely, accessible,
well,
harmonious food, and you changed...
Well, that wasn't my restaurant, and the only reason I made a salad was because... The agreement with the owners was that I would serve a salad, a pasta, and a vegetarian offering.
Was it only in your contract, actually?
Well, the handshake that was the contract involved those things, and I said I can make a salad, a pasta, and a vegetarian offering. So that's why I did it. It wasn't because I wake up burning to arrange lettuces on a plate.
Right. But, so what was the most? I mean, what was the most difficult point for you?
You know, I mean,
moment?
The most difficult. Restaurants are inherently difficult on a sort of day to day, minute to minute, hour to hour basis, and I think that's probably what we like about them is that they are challenging, in a sort of ongoing, ever evolving way. But you know, it's frustrating when you do something that you believe in and people are initially, you know, Tim Sagat said to me, he said, you know, in 6 months you're going to be serving a salad. And 11 and a half years later, we're still not serving a salad. So, you know, those are moments that are disappointing. But, I think that I did that to myself. Don't feel bad for me. I mean, those were conscious decisions on my part to seek not necessarily a harder route, but maybe a more unusual route. But, you know, we've been very lucky, and I think people come down to WD-50 and to Alder these days, and they have things that they can have a little bit of a smile, and they see the humor and the playfulness.
But I think the whole dining scene has changed. I mean, now the American diners are not the same as European diners, who are more accustomed necessarily maybe to certain avant-garde expression. But you know, I mean, it's been a long time, and you're known for that. But there must have been moments in the early when you started with WD-50 when you know you say like people are not getting it. And
well, sure. I could have brought a long list of people that have said bad things about have not enjoyed their meals at WD-50. But you know, again, we were very fortunate. 71 was, like you said, a very well-received restaurant, and WD was maybe a departure in that sense. But I think it's always been an honest and a genuine approach. And you know, the idea of that restaurant was to create a place where we could continue our education, where we could continue to learn about food and what's involved in the we don't know a lot about cooking as chefs. Even though we make delicious food, we don't really understand it very much. And we wanted to create a place where we could continue to learn and continue to evolve and understand. And you know, we made some clunkers along the way. I'm not going to lie. I think everybody does that. You make some things that you wish maybe, or you look back. Right now, we're in the process of working on a cookbook. You know, in the last few months of our life, and we've looked back at literally hundreds and hundreds of dishes. And there are some of them I go, oh, geez, thank God that's. Nobody talks about that one. But you make some mistakes, but hopefully you make some delicious food that people can have fun with. And I don't think of a particular moment that gives me dread or anything like that.
Massimo, you went through some difficult times. I think again, it's much easier to get accepted in New York.
Very difficult.
In Modena, a small town, super conservative, where again, you know, you put like an extra prezzemolo, an extra parsley, and people go, burn him at the stake. And you've gone through some very difficult times with the whole scandal.
Yeah.
Tell us about that.
It was 2007. We saw not far. We were 2008, and we were on London, and we were almost ready to go on stage, and I was having the prize of I climbed the 50 best restaurant, and became the best restaurant in Italy, and my phone started ringing and ringing and ringing and ringing, and I said, well, they already know what's going on here before me. And I was leaning and I said, I'm supporting you, I'm with you. And I didn't get it. And then I started calling someone, and they told me that on this TV scandalistic program at the called Striscia la Notizia, and watched by millions of people every night. They were saying that in Osteria Francescana, I was poisoning people. I was just using this technique that I was ruining. You know, in Italy, you can do whatever you want. You know, just choose something, you can do it. You don't have to just touch the soccer national team. So we are like 70 million of coach for the soccer team. So we know exactly the team that we can win the world champion. Second, the Pope. So Pope Francis is the Pope. So you don't have to touch the Pope. The Pope is there. And your grandmother recipes. So if you do something like that, or you do like a screw something, you know, you're done. So I think instead of poisoning people, I think I was poisoning an idea or young generation or You know, I was just asking myself those kind of questions. Tradition, really respect the ingredients? Because the answer, if it's no, it's my things that I have to change the recipe. I have to modify. I have to bring that recipe into the future, thinking about my past in a not in a nostalgic way, but in a critic way, to bring just the best from the past into the future. This is the point.
But as we were talking to you before, I mean, some countries have a very strong and very well-defined tradition that, you know, exerts its pull. Spain, for example, you know, when they started innovating, they were riffing off something that everyone understood, and there was a mutual agreement about what a gazpacho is and, you know, what you're deconstructing. And in a way, it was, the cuisine was very convincing. On the other hand, the Scandinavians kind of invented the whole thing because, you know, nobody, you know, even locals right now in Copenhagen, none of the disciples of this avant-garde chef René Redzepi actually has opened anything neo-traditional because they're kind of running away from their food, you know, this is Protestant thing. But Wally, what is the new American food? I mean, American food is already so hard to define in the first place. So what are you deconstructing and what, you know, what is the new American food?
On New York food.
Well, I mean, for me, it's about. I think the food at any great restaurant is a reflection of its location, of where they are, and for us, we have a great luxury. We're in New York City, which means I can use, let's say, French technique, but I can include Mexican spices, and I can use a piece of fish from Japan, and I'm cooking very authentic New York style food. I mean, we're at a hub. We have a luxury because we're in a world hub, and so I think for a chef, a cook to help himself or herself to these ingredients, these techniques from all over the place, as long as you do it in a sensible, intelligent, and delicious way, it can be authentically New York. You know, I mean, I remember many years ago, Mario Batali saying, "I'm not making Italian food. I'm making New York food. I'm taking Italian ingredients, Italian ideas, and I'm giving them a spin based on where I am." And that really resonated with me, that here's somebody who's actually understanding his location and not pretending to be authentic. Sicilian lifeguard, that's nothing. That's a made-up notion, you know? And it was a huge hit, his squid Sicilian lifeguard style. Yeah. And it just because he was clever and figured out how to give it a spin, a local spin. And that's all we're doing. I mean, we're taking very familiar things like Eggs Benedict or an everything bagel with cream cheese and salmon and having some fun with it. But other times we're taking things that seem disparate, but to me they're all things that exist here. They didn't necessarily grow here because we're in a land of stone and glass and concrete, and there isn't a ton of absolutely local agriculture, but there's a ton of wonderful ingredients and foodstuffs that we have access to. So to be authentically American in that sense is to use what's around you, what's in front of you. And sometimes we play with, you know, apple pie, ice cream, vanilla ice cream, and things that are. I mean, we still have iconic American dishes, I think, that we can have fun with. Like I said, I mean, you know, Eggs Benedict is something that we work on.
Tell us about your Eggs Benedict.
Well, it's not the Eggs Benedict of your youth, the memory of Eggs Benedict means to you, is not what you're going to have at WD50 because we've taken the four essential elements: an egg, a poached egg, Canadian bacon, English muffins, and hollandaise sauce, and mixed it around. So we've deep fried hollandaise, crusted it in the crumbs of an English muffin. We've dried the Canadian bacon. And we've cooked just the egg yolk in a way that is more closely related to some sort of cheese or fudge. So it comes down, you say, I'm not sure that's what I ordered, but if you were to take everything and put it on a fork and put it in your mouth and close your eyes, I still think that you could be transported to that moment that Eggs Benedict means, whether it was Sunday brunch just this past weekend with your kids, or if it was a memory that you had with your grandmother, you know, her making you, or going to the diner, whatever it is. I'm not trying to corrupt that memory, but I'm trying to have some fun with it. We're trying to have some fun with it.
Well, in a way, you're trying to make it fresher, because by deconstructing it and kind of making it slightly strange, you know, you taste it new. Because, you know, something of memories are faded, food is too familiar, and then when you see something taken apart and put together in the mouth, you know, suddenly you go, oh, wow. that tastes...
But I don't want to corrupt your memory. I just want you to engage it in a different way, in a slightly different way. I want you to have and go, now I'm there. It took me a second. Because I'm not changing the flavors of it.
No, exactly. But
changing
by
the way
sort of
you interact
it,
with
by
it
presenting
slightly.
It in a different
way. But I'm not trying to. I'm not trying to upset you necessarily. You know.
I'm upset.
But
I'm
there is
devastated.
There is a very important artist called Ai Weiwei, that in one of his famous pieces is like is there, he's standing there, and he drop a 2,000 years old vase. He drop on the floor, and. He's dropping and breaking this vase. He said, I'm not defining my past. I'm rebuilding the past from all these pieces and through a contemporary mind with all this experience, try to redefine what is going to be China of the future. You know, it's one of the pieces that for me means, they really mean a lot. Because when I talk about my cuisine and what I'm doing in Modena, I'm like, just bring a little bit of this powder. This is the powder of a 2,000 years old vase. I'm passed through a contemporary mind, and this is my cuisine. It's very easy. I'm not losing anything from my past, but I look at the past in a very in a different way.
Well, you talk about seeing tradition from 10 kilometers away.
Yes.
Tell us what you mean by that.
To me, it's like if you step back from my tradition, from where I'm from, and I see everything so clear, I see everything very clear. There was everything start. because this very important gallerist from Modena was telling me this story, no, about Gino De Dominicis, a very, very good artist. It was a very eccentric artist. Never did a portrait in his life. But this incredible, you know, artist, it was like full of imagination. And one day, this he decided to do this portrait of this collector. That it was like going on and on and on and calling him and call the gallery and just pushing him. To create a portrait of himself, and he said, "Okay, you can come tomorrow, and I'm gonna make a portrait of you." You know, after 6 months of pushing, so he arrived around 9, and Gino was still in bed, and with the aisle, the canvas there, he wake up, he start having breakfast. He let the collector sitting at on the couch. He start reading the newspaper. He start making phone calls, and you know, the time for lunch arrive. Order lunch. Eating lunch. Then the collector gets very nervous because the canvas was there, waiting for Gino, and at one point. He left his place. He went close to the canvas. He touched the color. He marked the center of the canvas with a point of red. The collector arrived. He saw the canvas. He was like, "What's going on in Erefa? This is a portrait of a collector from 10 kilometers of distance." So you see everything, but you can, you know, it's exactly the same thing we are doing. You know, you taste the Parmigiano Reggiano in all the different texture and temperature, emotion. You feel everything, but you don't see a piece of Parmigiano Reggiano. It's what Wiley was saying before about Egg Benedict. Exactly the same way.
No, it's as I say, it's a way of kind of slightly estranging yourself, you know, slightly distancing yourself from the immediate emotion of the dish, and, you know, making it sound new again, taste new again, without, as you say, destroying, you know, the original emotion.
Absolutely.
Or maybe awakening an emotion that you never thought you had. I mean, that's the thing. I mean, we eat so much food and it becomes overly familiar, and like, how many times did you say, "Oh, wow, I'm like," tasting a burger for the first time here. You know, either the dish has to be traditional and just amazingly great, or it had to be slightly tweaked made new again. How would you describe your styles of cooking? I mean, these days, us people in the media are very quick to kind of attach monikers, deconstructivist, traditional New American, the dreaded, molecular cuisine, which all the chefs absolutely hate because it's meaningless and it's ugly.
Because it doesn't mean anything.
It doesn't mean anything. In 10 words or less, how would you describe your style, or if there's one dish that kind of captures it?
I don't think that there's a single dish that captures it. I think it's more, on the contrary, it's more maybe an amalgam of things. But, hot food that tastes good. I don't need to give it like a big fancy name. It's never been that important to fit into a box for me. I don't really care what you call it, and I don't mean that in a flip way. I just mean honestly, whatever helps you to describe it. Modern American, contemporary American. I'm a chef in New York using the most modern techniques as well as honoring the ancient past. Mm. I mean, I was just reading a cookbook last week about medieval cookery in Islam, and I came across a recipe for a soup made from bread, and it reminded me of some of the toasted bread soups that I used to make working for some of the great chefs of France. And I was wondering how we could incorporate something like that into a dish at WD50. So it doesn't really necessarily matter to me. I've exceeded my 10 words. I realize that.
No, it's okay. 10 words were.
We're trying to be very aware of what other people around the world is doing. So when I was 20 years old, and I always take notes. I have a pocket full of notebooks right now that I won't bore you with, but I take notes all the time. And when I was 20 years old, I wrote an idea down. I was going to do a chocolate cake with a liquid center. And I thought, now that is an idea, right? That's a good idea. I still have the book. I thought, what a great idea. Fast forward, 2 years later, I'm working for Jean Georges, and every night I'm putting a chocolate cake on a plate with a liquid center. And I was like, okay, I need to get a little bit more on board with what's going on in the world because I'm a little behind, And so I'm trying to be acutely aware of what the people in my past have done, in our past. We stand on the shoulders of everyone else. I mean, we are not burdened the way Massimo is in terms of rigorous attention to authenticity or anything like that. Like, people called me a witch for completely different reasons, not because I was changing recipes a little bit, but because I was not paying attention to them at all, maybe. But we're paying attention to the past and also constantly aware of very modern things, right, and seeing how we can bring those together in hopefully a fun, playful, and delicious way, right, or maybe a delicious, fun, and playful way.
Well, there exists this idea that traditional innovation are mutually self-exclusive, which couldn't be farther from the truth. And Massimo, I know you thought about this a lot. I mean, how does innovation move tradition forward?
It was very, very important. I call that tradition in evolution. Tradition in evolution can be something that is completely different, or tradition or evolution. No, it's not true. It's tradition in evolution. I keep thinking about evolving a tortellino or evolving a tagliatelle ragù. So it's like I had to do it, and I want to do it. But you have to arrive at that point that is like when you know that that point is there. So I'm thinking about tagliatelle ragù.
Tagliatelle ragù is the most traditional
dish
in Emilia-Romagna.
Yeah, not too far than 2 weeks ago. We were keeping evolving this kind of plate. So it's like, it's still there. Tagliatelle ragù is a key plate for me because, I was doing all these kind of crazy things, when I saw and I was working in Ferran, this whole spherification process drove me nuts, and I didn't like it because, I didn't have that kind of reaction in the palate and the flavor. So I was thinking about a natural spherification process that was they came from my past. So this small embryon eggs that was inside the chicken when my mom was serving the chicken and was creating the broth, and we were, I remember me and my brother, we were fighting over those embryons. And so I was thinking about that's a real spherification, is a natural spherification. So it's just the incredible taste of eggs and yolk. And so to create a tagliatelle ragù, I was fishing into my past and the memory that when my grandmother was cutting the pasta, I was stealing the pasta and make it crunchy on a pan, and using that pan, touching with ragù, and have tagliatelle ragù like that, crunchy tagliatelle ragù. But at one point, I was thinking, okay, if I'm boiling this a little bit into the embryon eggs, I'm gonna take off some egg yolk from there and inject some ragu, and I put on my crunchy triangle. I think this is a flavor of tagliatelle ragu. And people, they were like looking at me like, what the hell is going on here? And then at one point, this gallerist, always the Emilio, would say, Massimo, stop provocate people. You have to pass in the right way. I want a tagliatelle, right. And tagliatelle ragù in just perfectly made. So the art came and helped me. You know, there's a current of art called Transavanguardia from the late 70s and beginning of 80s, where all these incredible artists, Italian artists, from Chia, Cookie, Clemente, Palladino, they start painting again. And you know, they were painting in a totally different way. Chia was painting like an old Etruscan. Palladino as an old Greek from Sicily. And you know, Cookie, he was painting walls as San Francisco and the mountain. It's well back to the order. They wanna put figures on canvas. So I said, okay, I'm gonna do the tagliatelle ragù, the best tagliatelle ragù ever. And I create this tagliatelle after 6 months of research on the best tagliatelle, best tagliatelle, best tagliatelle. But the reason and the idea arrived from my grandmother when she was like telling me all the story about pasta. And if you use a lot of yolk making pasta, you know that the pasta is gonna be very tasty. And when you roll it, you know that it's gonna be very difficult to roll it. And if you don't cut it when it's perfect, when you cook it, it's gonna break in different parts and it's gonna ruin all the water. So all these are old wise suggestion from my grandmother. And then I remember that she was telling me, if you buy the ground meat is not gonna grab on the tagliatelle. So the meat has to be big pieces and has to be chopped by hand, because like that, the ragu is gonna grab on the pasta. So starting from there, I rebuilt this old tagliatelle ragu with these big pieces of meat, the sous vide way of cooking, chopping by hand, eliminate all the butter, the parmigiano, and at the end, to finish with the perfect flavor, the parmigiano, everything came out from an experimentation things that I found out coming back from Australia. So this is kind of, okay, are you following me? Okay, coming back from Australia, we had all this flavor that was all, they taste all the same. And was just dashi, 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 bonito, bonito, bonito. It's like a broth with, you slice this, okay? You know, are you familiar with bonito and dashi? Okay, it's Japanese umami flavor that you just extract with warm water and you extract this flavor. So I said, why they are serving us all this bonito and dashi with bonito? I'm going to Japan to taste this flavor. Why don't they do dashi with crocodile or dashi with kangaroo?
Crocodile.
Yeah.
That's
why not?
Crocodile dashi.
Yeah. I was thinking, you know, I'm going to create a dashi with Parmigiano Reggiano. So I broke the big wheels of Parmigiano, the older one, and I started slicing the Parmigiano as bonito. And I was pouring water on the top of this sliced Parmigiano. And you know, the day after, I was reheating the Parmigiano till like it was like 80 degrees, and out of the blue, I saw this all this protein dropping down. The water was in the middle, and on the top, I saw the whole surface of this broth that was creamy. So the Parmigiano was composed in three different layers. The protein was at the base, and it didn't have any taste. In the middle, there was this incredibly intensive flavor of water of Parmigiano, and on the top, you had this fantastic creamy sauce from this extraction. So I decided to finish the tagliatelle with one spoon of that cream. That's it. Instead of using butter, Parmigiano, that's it. And the tagliatelle just finish in the round circle of taste that is the perfect taste.
And I have to tell you, it's completely transformative. You know, this is what happens. I think, I mean, I've just eaten, I'm not Massimo for how many years, I've just eaten there recently, and I think he's reaching a stage where, you know, all this kind of avant-garde techniques and knowledge and science, you know, you kind of return to basics, you return to simplicity, but you're completely transformed. So like one teaspoon, one finishing touch can suddenly, you know, make you see tagliatelle as you never tested it before, or tortellini. Wally, are you ready to go back to like a straight ahead Eggs Benedict?
I mean, if you're going to make it for me anytime, yeah. I mean, I love,
all right.
I love Eggs Benedict.
It's so hard.
One of my favorite things.
No, but are you reaching the stage where, you know, all this kind of experimentation and you kind of ready to...
I mean, I'm not ready to stop playing with my food. I'm not ready to stop learning about what I'm doing. I'm not ready to stop having fun. I mean, you know, we're trying to figure out how to make lasagna out of scallops instead of out of pasta.
Wow.
You know, maybe I should bring Massimo in for a tutorial because we're playing, you know, but no, I mean, why not necessarily, no. I mean,
no, I'm just asking. I mean, you don't have to.
I mean, I have it until the end of November, right? And then I...
no, don't remind me. So what's next for you after, do you have any plans?
I'm going to take a nap.
We're crying. We're all crying. And after you take a nap?
I don't know. I don't know. We don't have a new home to go to. So,
well,
I mean, obviously we still have Alder and we're very excited about Alder. And let's not forget
fantastic.
About that.
Fantastic.
You know,
fantastic.
But,
So fittingly, a question from reader. What are your thoughts, both of you, on the next steps in modernist cuisine?
I mean, I think the value in modernist cuisine lies in what it teaches, what it's teaching us. You know, again, I think we've been cooking delicious food for millennia, but we haven't really understood what we're doing. And so more and more we're learning what we're doing. And I think modernist cuisine, whatever that exactly means, is, I believe, a search for knowledge. And I think that will never end. That will never be considered over or out of fashion. So for me, the excitement I have for that term, modernist cuisine, lies in the fact that it's an endless opportunity for knowledge. So we're just going to keep learning.
Massimo?
I would love to ask someone what he thinks about modernist cuisine. I don't know if he's on a stage. Is he here?
We can see. Who asked the question?
Is there?
Hi.
No, there is a friend of us. I don't know where he is.
Oh.
Come on, I don't see you.
I think a friend.
I don't see you. Where are you?
I think a friend is backstage.
Is there?
Who is there?
Dave.
Uh-oh.
Come on.
Come and join the group. You missed.
I don't miss you.
You're not missed.
No. No, okay. Modernist cuisine. What is modernist cuisine?
No, what is the next step?
I was there at the modernist cuisine at Nathan place 3 days ago. So I've seen very interesting things, very interesting experimentation. And, you know, I brought back some ideas and but.
But your question was probably, you know, broader sense, modern
for the
cuisine,
next,
not Nathan's.
No. What we are doing now is that it's totally different. The cuisine right now is like is no more like 15 years ago. What we are serving is not is just yeah. We use old technique and we having fun and we play jokes and you know like we create played like oops I dropped the lemon tart or like 1,000 leaves of leaves. You know, it they're like fun and. And things, but actually right now we are using the technique not to show the ego of the chef, but to sublimate the ingredients. That is a totally different approach, you know? When we were like, do you remember like 15 years ago, we were like, wow, and this, and presenting all this air and smoke that was coming up from this. And, you know, I don't think the contemporary cuisine is like that right now. And it's totally changed. And I think it's changed because we start sharing and breaking barriers. You know, me, Wiley, Dave, Renee, or like Alex Atala, you know, all these guys that like we get together, we start becoming friends, we start sharing ideas, and you know, these all things change completely the, I think, our way of seeing gastronomy.
And I think there's a kind of, I think historicism is something that people are thinking about. I mean, going back to the 13th century recipe, you know, kind of the new historicism, what Heston has been doing with dinner. Mm. I mean, I'm seeing it all over the place little by little. And, you know, to me, it's very fascinating, you know, going back not just to yesterday, but to, you know, a distant past, you know, what you were talking about, you know. Another question for both of you. Who are you inspired by right now? Doesn't have to be a chef. Or it can be a chef. Voilà.
I mean, well, inspiration is a funny thing because it can happen from so many different ways and so and in so many different forms. But, you know, I like to... I've been a voracious cookbook reader my whole life, and you know, I am continually inspired by the other chefs around me, certainly inspired by the people I work with. You know, I like to see what other people are up to. You know, inspiration is a funny thing. It's not quite so easily defined in many ways, I think, but I think for me, just sort of knowing what other people are up to and seeing, like, I think Massimo's point of the openness that exists now that wasn't always the case.
It was new, and now.
And the sharing of ideas is allowed, you know, as well as the internet and things like the world getting smaller, but just the ability to share and have ideas and talk about things. But, you know, I guess. You know, lately I haven't traveled as much and been a part of these food conferences as much as I once was, but I find inspiration now for me, and maybe because I'm in a sort of a nostalgic moment and the heels of a restaurant closing, but being with the team and talking about ideas and working with the younger people and working with the younger cooks, because the cooks are younger and younger than they were when I first got started, and just sort of explaining to them how things work. And I find that very inspirational, being able to help these younger people see things, understand things, look at a piece of fish and understand its anatomy, as well as think about a dish and how we can balance out the flavors. I find working with the team right now is what is really inspiring or that I get excited about, is the ability to be with the cooks and help them get somewhere that someone helped me get to.
Massimo, you're an art collector, an intellectual, you know, music connoisseur. I mean, your idea, you know, you're known for your cross-pollination of ideas. You know, your inspirations, you know, could come from Gertrude Stein, or, you know, art or radish. What's exciting you right now?
No, it's true. It's books or music or art is something, is the highest point of culture, and artists are there and are the... You know, Seria Francescana is the inspirational, you know, is the our landscape of ideas, you know, You can read the book and you see art or music or everywhere. And there is like this description of how they inspire us, how we arrive at that point, how we arrive at to define that. Of course, the team is amazing, and it's the most important thing, because if otherwise, but you have to acculturate them. And how we, and what I do in Osteria, I'm like, every couple of weeks I give words to the people in the room, to the people in the kitchen, and they have to know, and they have to know what we are doing. We are doing, like a couple of months ago, we were talking about Russian constructivism. And, you know, when I ask, who knows about Gonkarova, Larionov, or Russian constructivism, no one answered. And so I said, okay, in 48 hours, I want 2 pages about Russian constructivism.
Can you imagine working in the kitchen and getting an assignment to write about an art book?
No, it's very important. It's very important because Russian constructivism, you see the spaces in the plate, and you see a cylinder, and you move, and a rectangle, and a line, and a circle, and you know, it's very important.
Send them to the Malevich show at the Tate. It's
unbelievable.
From constructivism to another question, Massimo, who has the best red sauce in New York? Or where do I need to go to find it?
Oh, we are talking about something very serious.
Yeah.
Something very serious. Because pasta al pomodoro
is
like,
yeah.
You know,
don't even write it. No, you can't.
When I arrived in Ducasse Place in 1992, I was like, the first thing he asked me is to make a roasted chicken. Cazzo, roasted chicken. Okay, making roasted chicken, and that was the first question he asked, and he wanted to see me to make a roasted chicken. And the first thing I ask now, when the people they're coming to Osteria Francescana, is making a plate of spaghetti al pomodoro, and I understand immediately how if they can make it. And in New York City, maybe Torrisi, Mario, yeah.
They make spaghetti?
I have no idea, because I never asked for spaghetti al pomodoro, come on. It's like, but actually I had an idea about Wiley and the lasagna, because he was telling me that, I love that challenging about lasagna. Because, you know, it's like, I'm like, you know that. You know what could be very interesting is like transform lasagna. Is everyone knows that lasagna is like. Actually, we know we wrote about lasagna and all the crunchy part and the corner, but the things that would be very very interesting to play north and south, and you know arrive at the lasagna that is classic north plate with handmade pasta with eggs and stuff. But arriving from south, so transforming a liner spaghetto in lasagna. You understand what I mean?
No.
Yeah, it's very easy.
Does anyone
like, if you... if you overcook the spaghetto, you get the spaghetto, and you overcook a spaghetto, what do? You just overcook spaghetto, no? And you have, you reduce, and you have a very creamy sauce. You put in a blender, and you create this,
mess.
No, it's clear and clear. The more I think, the more it's clear in my mind. But you know, as the photographer, you know, is photographing, you know, the chaos as a chaos, you know. In my mind and in the kitchen, you know, I know everything is clear. So if you overboil the pasta and you reduce the water, you have a creamy thing that you spread in the top of the something that you put in the oven, and you cook it again, and then you put in a dehydrator.
In the what?
In a
dehydrator.
Dehydrator, sorry. In a dehydrator. Putting in a dehydrator get very crunchy. At that point, you can fry that. and comes out a very interesting pasta that is like very, very airy and light. Then you put it in a green egg.
Are you
and you burn it, and you burn it, and you smoke it a little bit. So it's
can
like
smoke
the
it?
Corner of the big pan of lasagna that, you know, you get it and you feel it. And you transform a spaghetti into a lasagna. All that's right. A very interesting
who
thing.
Who can stand up and read back the recipe?
You're welcome.
All right, can we move on to another question? As pioneers of avant-garde cuisine, what do you think of Ferran Adrià's El Bulli Foundation plans and the Bulipedia Library?
I'm not an expert on either of those subjects, but I think it's great. I mean, I think it's pretty cool what he's got planned and what he's composing and compiling. And I think, again, it's just bringing information to a place where more people will have access to it and understand it and cataloging some things and also creating a place where people can get together and ideas can continue to grow and ferment. I mean, I don't see how you could criticize it. It seems like it's a good idea. It's a place where some sort of culinary education can go on and continue to foster. So I think, broadly speaking, I think it's a great idea. I mean, it's coming to us very shortly, right? So
yeah, and it's very exhaustive and rigorous. We were locked in, you know, in a conclave a few months ago, I think it was last March, with Ferran, you know, and he brought, you know, some of journalists, you know, some, and we each had to deliver a whole thing about, like, what our cuisines are and what were the important moments, and there were people writing things on the wall, and the wall was covered with stuff, and it was just up to, you know, and he's questioning everything, that's the thing. He doesn't take anything for granted. He's like, what is sugar? Or, you know, what is a soup? What is a gazpacho? So I think, I mean, the whole idea of knowledge being absolute is a little suspect. I don't think he's quite aware of that. I mean, I think he said, well, this has to be this. You know, he kind of divides this is objective and this is subjective. I mean, there's no such thing as objective knowledge, you can argue. But I think it's a very, very serious project, and it will be amazing. What do you think, Massimo?
Personally, when I have to talk about Ferran, I don't think. I just say, yes, it's okay. And that's it. Because also, if you talk, he doesn't listen to you. So I don't lose time for that. And I say, yeah, fantastic. Fantastic idea. That's
true. Yeah. Another question from Massimo. Would you ever open a restaurant in New York? Why and why not? And if yes, is this something you are actively pursuing?
Because I need work.
And we need pasta. We need pasta al pomodoro.
No, we were planning before to open in Barcelona, but you know, an American, Barcelona. Italian, Spanish with Albert. So we'll see. When I'm gonna be ready to move to New York? But now I'm not ready to move to New York because I think to open a restaurant in New York, you have to be in New York. And being in the restaurant. Otherwise, the New Yorker, they don't, you know, it's very important. Right now, I'm like, I just opened in Istanbul, and I think I have quite a lot of things to think about than open a restaurant in New York. But as soon as my wife is from New York, and you know, I have you know, parents here and in-laws here. That would be something fantastic for me. But
fantastic for New York
in the future. Please. But Enrique is going to open very soon. So another friend of us. So
well, Enrique, he's not opening it.
You know, we were at the round table, a few days ago, me and Wiley, and we were talking about New York, and I said to me, right now is the most exciting place in the world where you can eat. Mm. You know,
is that London is exciting.
London, but in a different way. New York is more, you know, there's more energy. London is like this. You know, yesterday I was in Central Park. We did this burger. I brought this idea of bringing, you know, product from Modena, mixing with burger, analyzing the burger in a critic way. So rebuilt a burger as it was Emilia. Thousands of people at Madison Park, but thousands. You know, our burger was over in a couple of hours. People, they were waiting at 8 o'clock in the morning, you know, waiting for the burger. This is amazing. You know, we don't have this kind of spirit. We don't have, in Europe, people, if you look at people right now, it's like, they're sad.
Because we have good burgers.
No, because we are in a very deep crisis that is not an economic crisis, it's an identity. You know, we think everything is a disaster. You know, no. When I come in New York, I'm like, get so emotion and recharge all the battery. I just want to go back home and break everything. You know?
No, it's true. I just came back from five months in Europe.
You know.
And I'm it's really nice here. Massimo, this is a cryptic one. Is the door to Osteria always kept closed? Or did we just arrive earlier?
No, repeat. I don't.
Is the door to Osteria always kept closed? Or did we just arrive earlier?
You just arrived earlier. We keep the door open, closed, because we want to keep the door closed. And then,
so do we.
If you ring the bell, we're going to open. But
okay, one more for Massimo.
Oh, well, why? Bye. What time did you arrive? I don't know.
8:30.
Yeah.
Massimo again. What do you hope for the future of Italian cuisine? Will Italian cuisine be able to respect tradition without fearing innovation beyond Massimo Bottura?
I think right now, as we did in like sharing around the world, we create a very solid group of chefs from north to south. They are very into local, but after the experience, internationally experienced, like Limor, Norbert Niederkofer, Pino Kutaya, Krakow, you know, and they're like trying to do, it's a very exciting moment, but we don't realize that, you know, because of everything that is around us. And but it's a great moment for the new generation. And I think we are aware for the tradition, we are very respectful, but we love to break this kind of tradition and see the things from another point of view, maybe from under the table, to see the world in a different point of view. And I think Italian cuisine, sorry for everyone, and you know, with the French cuisine right now, they're still the best cuisine in the world. Is what I think.
To go back to your project, I mean, you both, you know, it's sort of the whole role of the chef has expanded so much. You know, chef is a celebrity, he's on TV. You know, is a role model.
I'm not going TV.
No, I'm just saying chefs in general. You know, someone like Ferran. No, you go on TV. Someone like Ferran Adrià, you know, was in Documenta and had art shows. There's a lot of talk about social commitment, like the group of chefs, you know, around Renata Zeppi, Alex Atala. You know, social responsibility is really important. And, you know, another thing, of course, is that you have to write a cookbook, but you both, for a very long time, resisted. And I hear, Wiley, you have one in the work, and we're here to celebrate Massimo's. Wiley, why did it take you so long, and tell us about your project.
Are you going to read my book?
It's in English, right?
Yeah.
It's in English.
And I'm going to read it.
Okay.
I promise. There's a lot of pictures?
A lot of pictures. It's all in English. Big type, really easy to read, easy words, you know, nothing.
Why did it take us so long? Well, you know, for a long time, I didn't think that we had enough to say. I didn't think that we had amassed enough information. We didn't understand enough to make a book. And I feel like now we've amassed enough information to fill a book that I think we have something to offer, something to contribute to the community, to the industry. I mean, for me, I want to be additive. I want to add something to the dialogue, to the conversation. And it's taken us a while, I think, to get there. And then, and at this point, we're sort of accelerating the pace because we only have a limited amount of time.
When's your deadline?
Well, November 30th, the restaurant's closing. So it's hard to write a book once the restaurant's gone. So we're trying to accomplish as much as we can. I mean, obviously, there will be things that will happen post-mortem. But
you're shooting the recipes.
We're trying to capture the spirit of the place with the amount of time we have left. But, you know, I think for a long time I didn't even think about it. Notionally, I was sort of focused on trying to keep chugging away and making WD-50 a better place. But it was also about feeling like we had enough to say, that we'd really gotten somewhere and that we really could leave the landscape a little bit better, you know, and add something to the conversation.
No, we're all really excited about it. Massimo, in your book, tell us about why you did it and what's in it, and they'll be signing after.
For me, it was just very difficult to share all this. And, you know, as soon as I was ready to write a recipe, the recipe was already old because we were changing. And, you know, for me it was like, wow, no, I cannot write a book. Then I had a conversation with Rene one night. And, the night conversation between chefs. And it was like 2 a.m, actually. And Rene was like, and Fiden was, I think, the best publisher company. Was just pushing me to sign, but I was resisting because I don't know. There was something inside that I didn't want to do it, and because I knew that was so big, I had so many things to say, and I wasn't maybe happy. So Rene told me, Massimo, stop it. Just you have to sign the book because you know every time you speak, you know it's so great and blah blah blah. And the day after, I called Emilia, and I said, Emilia, I'm ready to sign. Put down all the document, and let's do the things, but you have to leave me this, you have to leave me that, you have to do that. Then we start 6 months of like talking, and then I signed the book. Because I felt, you know, that was time to, also for the guys from my team, there are all this team is like is so strong, and there are people like Taka, Davide that are with me since 10 years ago, Beppe 15. So it's like time also for them to have and to see something, to touch it, paper, and to read all the story, and to write about what it is, a recipe that is not just create good food. There is a big story behind, you know, what we do in Osteria is like we put together all this passion we have and we compress into edible bites, you know? And so this is what is...
No, the book is absolutely, absolutely extraordinary. What time is it? How are we doing for time?
9:35. I have no idea how we're doing for time.
Okay. Let me see if we have one more question. I think we had an hour, yeah? Okay. I think we're there.
Are there some questions from...
Yes, anybody with another question?
Yeah, there's one. Dave, you have some question?
Is it true that Italian food is just Chinese food?
I already answered at Lucky Peach. I was inspired by this incredible Chinese chef, but that's the point. That we were playing jokes like that, and you know, a chef, you know, a young chef approached me in Italy saying, chef, that, you know, I already bought the ticket to go in China, but can you tell me exactly where to go? And I didn't get it, you know, I didn't realize what he was talking about. And and was just something that we came out, me, Dave, you know, when we were in Copenhagen, you know, one afternoon with Chris. And, you know, because, you know, I read on Lucky Peach that your inspiration is this Chinese chef. Then he's teach you how to make the perfect pasta al pomodoro or lasagna. I said, no, it's not true. So don't buy the ticket. Oh, really? Don't buy the ticket. It's just something that we came up like that. It's just to play. And I said, oh, okay. So we have to be careful to say something like that, Dave.
We actually just put a dish from 71 Clinton on the menu at Alder last week. We took our goat cheese, potato bacon and goat cheese tart that was on the menu at 71 Clinton, and we put it on the brunch menu at Alder. We just revamped the whole brunch menu at Alder. So no, I think part of going forward always involves looking backwards, and so we're constantly going backwards and looking what we've done in the past. And 71 is a 71 Clinton Fresh Food was my first job on my own as a chef, and it was a lot of fun for me. And originally, for the first 7 or 8 years of WD50, every year on New Year's Eve we would put a 71 dish or two on the New Year's Eve menu as well. So we're constantly going back there, and those are very fond days for me. Hard days, but in a good way, but fond days. So no, I love going back there, and I love those dishes, and I hope that they still resonate, and you'll decide by how many tarts you order on Sunday.
Didn't you have the avocado at Alder as well?
We had the salmon avocado on the menu, our opening menu at Alder as well, which is another...
So good.
Another 71 dish.
Well, on that happy note, I think we're being told to thank you all for coming. And hopefully you'll come up and Massimo will send a book. And it's been a really, really exciting time talking to you guys. And I can't wait to hear what you're up to next.
Thank you.
Thank you. We'll be right back.